Good afternoon, and welcome to this virtual meeting of the Scottish Parliament. The first item of business is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon on COVID-19 update. The First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Nicola Sturgeon, First Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And firstly, I wish you, everyone in Parliament and across the country, a happy new year. Today, I will report on the continuing rise in COVID cases. I will outline our approach to managing this phase of the pandemic. Part of that, I'll set out immediate changes to the requirements for self-isolation and testing. And while we are not proposing any additional measures at this stage, I will confirm that existing protections and guidance will remain in place for the coming week, pending further review. And finally, given that Omicron may not be the last new COVID variant that we face, I will also signal some longer-term work to consider the adaptations necessary to enable us to deal more proportionately and sustainably with any future phases of the pandemic. First, though, today's statistics, 16,103 positive cases were reported yesterday, 26.9% of all tests carried out. 1,223 people are in hospital with COVID. That's 71 more than yesterday, but it is 544 more than at this time last week. 42 people are in intensive care, which is the same as yesterday, and sadly, a further 5 deaths have been reported, taking the total number of deaths under the daily definition to 9,872. And once again, I send my condolences to everyone who is mourning a loved one. The surge of cases driven by the extremely infectious Omicron variant is continuing here in Scotland, across the UK, and indeed in many other countries around the world. Here in Scotland, over the past week, the total number of new reported cases has increased by 87%. Tomorrow's figures will almost certainly see us pass 1 million reported cases since the outset of the pandemic. However, the rapid and very widespread transmission of Omicron is such that the daily recorded tally of cases, which has always been an underestimate of the true level of infection, now gives us an even less comprehensive indicator of how prevalent the virus is. The weekly survey published by the Office of National Statistics gives a better indication. In the week to 23rd December, it suggested that 1 in 40 people in Scotland had COVID. The results of the most recent ONS survey, published just a few minutes ago, suggest that in the week to 31st December, that had risen to 1 in 20. The proportion of people with COVID is, though, likely to be even higher than that now, a few days later, and I would anticipate that we will see continued growth in the level of infection as work and school resume after the holiday period. In short, COVID is significantly more widespread now than at any stage in the pandemic so far, and will almost certainly become even more so in the days to come. This, of course, has extremely serious implications for the NHS and social care, but it also has a severe and increasing impact on the economy and other critical services. This is primarily due to very high numbers of people off work with COVID, but it is, of course, compounded by the wider requirements for self-isolation. As I said last week, we have been considering very carefully the risks and benefits of changes to self-isolation requirements, and I will update on that shortly. More generally, as I said a moment ago, we are not proposing any new protective measures today. However, with the virus so prevalent, we do consider it's important to continue to apply some break on transmission, particularly in settings posing the highest risk. Accordingly, I can confirm that the restrictions on large gatherings, the requirement for distancing between groups of people in public indoor places, and for table service in hospitality venues serving alcohol on the premises will remain in force for now, and indeed I expect until the 17th of January. In addition, while this is not a legal requirement, we are continuing to strongly advise the general public to limit contact with people in other households as far as possible, and to limit the number of households in any indoor gathering that does take place to a maximum of 3. After 2 long years of this pandemic, I know that asking people to cut all social interaction is just not feasible, and it would be damaging, of course, to mental health and well-being. However, limiting contacts insofar as we can and thinking carefully about the interactions that matter most to us is important just now. It helps to stem, at least to some extent, increases in transmission, and so it has a collective benefit, but it also helps protect us as individuals. When at least 1 in 20 of us have the virus, as is the case now, the risk of getting it when we mix with others is really significant. So if we limit the occasions on which we do mix, we also reduce our own risk of catching a virus that we know could have a nasty impact on our health. Trying to stem transmission, at least to some degree, is also important for the NHS, which is under increasing pressure. On the upside, the evidence that Omicron causes less severe illness than previous variants, at least amongst the under 60s, where the virus is most prevalent at the moment, does appear to be strengthening. Indeed, the fact that the numbers here in intensive care are so far remaining stable, while the numbers in hospital are rising quite sharply, may be indicative of this. We also know for certain that a booster jab provides strong protection against serious illness for people of all ages. However, notwithstanding the success of the booster programme and indeed the apparent lower rate of hospitalisation from Omicron, the sheer volume of people becoming infected means more people with COVID are being admitted to hospital. There is also remaining uncertainty about the impact on hospital admissions if Omicron continues to spread from younger age groups, where the risk of falling seriously ill from COVID has always been lower, to those in older age groups. As I reported last week, work is also underway to better understand the detail behind the headline hospital numbers. I can advise Parliament that the first results from analysis to differentiate those who are in hospital because of COVID from those in hospital with COVID but who were admitted for different reasons will be published on Friday. Work has also been done to assess whether the average length of hospital stay resulting from Omicron is any different to that associated with other variants. So in short, our understanding of the precise nature and extent of Omicron's impact on hospitals and the wider health and social care system is still developing. However, what is beyond doubt is that it is already having a considerable impact. The number of people in hospital with COVID has increased from 679 to 1,223 in the past week. That's a rise of 80%, and that is putting significant additional pressure on the NHS. Indeed, the NHS is now facing increased pressure on three related fronts. First, from dealing with non-COVID backlogs built up over the course of the pandemic. Second, many NHS staff are absent and self-isolating, either because they have COVID or are close contacts of people with it. This means the increasing pressure on the NHS is being managed by a depleted and ever more exhausted workforce. And let me say, at this stage, we owe each and every one of them an enormous debt of gratitude. And third, as we keep saying, even with a lower rate of hospitalisation, the sheer volume of cases caused by the much greater transmissibility of Omicron is leading to more patients with COVID ending up in hospital. And with reference to the analysis to be published on Friday that I spoke about a moment ago, it's important to remember this. Even if COVID is not the primary reason for someone's admission to hospital, the fact they have COVID means enhanced infection control measures are necessary, and that further constrains the capacity of the NHS, so exacerbates that pressure. We continue to support health boards and staff to manage this pressure. This includes working with councils to reduce delayed discharge and targeting additional capacity where possible. Work is also underway, importantly, to develop alternative patient pathways for people with COVID, enabling them, where possible and appropriate, to remain at home with appropriate monitoring and advice rather than be admitted to hospital. And this work will also help identify at an earlier stage patients likely to benefit from new antiviral treatments. Of course, we can all help the NHS by taking steps to reduce transmission of the virus as much as possible. Presiding Officer, while abiding by current guidance and protections is at this stage vitally important, we do know that measures which restrict our lives are not sustainable indefinitely. And with a variant as infectious as Omicron, the kind of protections that are still possible within our financial resources and without causing greater harm in other ways, while still very important at this stage, won't control transmission to the same extent as these measures would have done with other less transmissible variants. So in light of this, coupled with the fact that, unfortunately, COVID won't suddenly disappear and that Omicron is unlikely to be the last new variant we encounter, we need to continue to adapt our thinking about how to manage the virus and become more resilient to it in future. Now, let me be clear at this stage, this does not, in my view, mean giving up on trying to control COVID completely. The impact of it on individual health and on our collective well-being is too significant for that. But it does mean seeking ways of doing so that are more proportionate, more sustainable and less restrictive. There are no easy answers here, but adapting to the ongoing challenge of COVID is inescapable. The Scottish Government is therefore currently working on and will publish over the next few weeks a revised strategic framework which will set out more fully how that process of adaptation can be managed with a view to building that greater resilience. We will seek views from across Parliament as we develop this new framework in more detail. However, the changes I am about to confirm to the requirements on self-isolation and testing are an early indication of an already adapting response. I said last week that it was important to consider carefully changes to self-isolation rules. We wanted to ensure that such changes are made only when, in the view of clinical advisers, the benefits of them outweigh the risks of them. I also want to make changes as far as possible in a coherent, not a piecemeal manner, given the importance of clear public understanding of what is required. As a result of this consideration, we are now proposing two changes to the self-isolation rules and one change to the requirement for PCR testing, and all of these changes will take effect from midnight tonight. The first change to self-isolation applies to those who test positive for COVID. While the initial advice when someone tests positive will still be to self-isolate for 10 days, there will now be an option to end isolation after 7 days, as long as you, firstly, have no fever, and secondly, you record two negative lateral flow tests, one no earlier than day 6 after testing positive, and another at least 24 hours after that. The second change applies to close contacts of positive cases, and this includes household contacts who are either under the age of 18 years, 4 months, or who are older than that and fully vaccinated. And let me be clear, by fully vaccinated, we mean first, second, and booster or third doses. For close contacts in these categories, the requirement to self-isolate will end and be replaced by a requirement to take a lateral flow test every day for 7 days. Obviously, if one of these tests is positive, self-isolation will then be required. Anyone identified as a close contact who is over 18 years and 4 months and not fully vaccinated will still be asked to self-isolate for 10 days and to take a PCR test. These changes are significant and they are not completely without risk. However, at this stage of the pandemic, they do strike an appropriate balance between the continued importance of self-isolation in breaking chains of transmission and reducing the disruption self-isolation causes in the economy and other critical services. We're also proposing an important change to the advice on testing, and let me be clear again, this has been very carefully considered. Scotland, indeed the UK as a whole, has one of the most extensive PCR testing systems anywhere in the world. However, with infection levels as high as they are, we must fully utilise all available testing capacity, PCR and lateral flow, and make sure isolation and advice happens as quickly as possible. For those who have symptoms of COVID, the advice remains to book a PCR test, even if you have a positive lateral flow test. And of course, the advice to everyone is to test regularly with lateral flow devices, especially before meeting up with others. However, from tomorrow, if your lateral flow test is positive and you do not have symptoms, you will no longer be required to take a PCR test to confirm the result. Instead, you must immediately isolate and also report your result online so that Test and Protect can commence the contact tracing process and give you advice as quickly as possible. You'll also receive an online form that you must fill in, as would happen with a PCR positive, to ensure your contacts are notified. Other countries, Canada, for example, have already made this change. It has been made possible because lateral flow tests are now widely available and work well. Also, and really importantly, the Test and Protect system in Scotland can start contact tracing on the strength of a reported positive lateral flow result, as well as a PCR. And crucially, at times of very high levels of infection, the risk of a false positive lateral flow result is very low indeed, around just 3 in 10,000. So the safest thing to do at this stage is to treat a positive lateral flow test as confirmation of COVID, even if you have no symptoms. This allows us to maximise testing capacity and ensure a speedier start to the process of contact tracing and advice. Signing Officer, there are a few further points I want to briefly touch on today. Firstly, the current situation continues to take its toll on everyone, of course, but it continues to take a toll on businesses. Last week, I confirmed the allocation of more than £200 million of the £375 million in business support we are making available. Today, I can confirm the allocation of a further £55 million. Up to £28 million will be allocated to taxi and private hire drivers and operators. £19 million will support services such as beauticians and hairdressers. £5 million will be provided for sport and an additional £3 million for tourism. Local authorities are, as we speak, working to get money to bank accounts as quickly as possible. Secondly, in light of the widespread community transmission of Omicron in the UK just now, discussions are taking place today between the four UK governments about possible changes to travel rules, including the requirement for pre-departure testing. If these discussions result in proposed changes, we will inform Parliament as quickly as possible. My third point relates to education and the start of the new term. All secondary school children are being asked to take a lateral flow test on the night before or morning of the first day back, and thereafter to test twice a week, and also in advance of mixing socially with people from other households. Likewise, university and college students should take a test immediately before travelling from home to term accommodation, and thereafter twice a week and before socialising with people from other households. And staff in all educational and early year settings should take a lateral flow test just before starting back to work, and in line with broader advice after that. Our priority is to keep schools open and to minimise further disruption to education, but with community transmission high, I know the next few weeks will be challenging for pupils, staff and parents. Using lateral flow tests will help, so too will the changes to isolation rules and updated education guidance reflecting these changes will issue shortly. We will also work with councils to ensure the guidance issued before Christmas is followed to keep schools not just open but as safe as possible. Signing Officer, my final brief update today is on vaccination. I am immensely grateful to everyone involved in delivering vaccines and to everyone who has been vaccinated. By the bells and Hogmanay, around 3 million people, 77% of those eligible, had received their booster or third dose. If you weren't one of these people and you are eligible, please come forward now. You can arrange an appointment online or go to a drop-in clinic. There's plenty of capacity. You can get details at NHS Inform or your local health board's website. Getting a booster doesn't mean we won't get COVID, although it does reduce the chances of that, but it significantly enhances our protection against serious illness. It could quite literally save your life. 12 to 15-year-olds can also now go to drop-in centres to get the second dose. I encourage everyone in that age group to do so. If you're the parent or carer of someone in that age group, you can go with them to the vaccination centre. The vaccine programme has been an outstanding success, but there are still many people eligible but not yet vaccinated. If you are one of them, then for your own sake and indeed for the sake of all of us, please rectify that. It is not too late and no one will judge you for not having done it before now. On the contrary, you will be welcomed with open arms. Signing officer, this phase of the pandemic is possibly the most challenging we've faced so far. The most infectious variant so far is creating a volume of cases that, notwithstanding its possibly reduced severity, still has the potential to overwhelm us. And of course, 2 years in, the kind of measures that have helped us control transmission in past phases are becoming less tolerable and causing more harm. So while not easy, we do need to continually adapt our ways of managing this virus, and we will do so. But in the meantime, we must continue to do what we know makes a difference now. So get fully vaccinated as soon as you can. Please do it this week. The more of us who are boosted, the less severe the impact of Omicron will be for each of us as individuals if we get the virus, and for society as a whole. Second, limit your contacts. Right now, with infection levels at 1 in 20 at least, every interaction we have comes with a significant risk of catching the virus. So we should prioritise the contacts that matter most to us. Third, if you're meeting other people, test before you go every time. And finally, take all the other precautions which make a difference. Work from home whenever possible. As the new working year gets underway, I'm appealing again to employers to enable this. Wear a face covering on public transport, in shops, and when moving about in hospitality, make sure it fully covers your mouth and nose. If you're meeting indoors, limit the number of households in your group to 3 at most, and keep windows open, and follow all advice on hygiene. I want again today, Presiding Officer, to record my thanks to everyone across the country who continues to do all of this and play their part in helping us through this latest very challenging phase of the pandemic. Thank you very much indeed, and I, of course, am happy now to take questions.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 55 minutes for questions, and I'd be grateful if members who wish to ask a question could please put an R in the chat function. And I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the changes to testing rules. These are sensible and proportionate changes that are similar to what we're seeing in other parts of the United Kingdom. I also welcome the changes to self-isolation, which the Scottish Conservatives have been calling for since day one. When they were introduced, we said this policy was not sustainable. Every other part of the United Kingdom made the change, but Scotland was left as an outlier. So, First Minister, why did it take so long to make this change here in Scotland?
First Minister.
I make no apology for considering these things very carefully. My clinical advice until now has been that it was possible that the risks of this in releasing people from self-isolation too early and therefore contributing to a greater increase in transmission outweighed the benefits. That balance of judgment has now changed, and after careful consideration, we are making this judgment today. None of these things are straightforward. I would doubt that there is any government anywhere that is making these decisions lightly. They certainly shouldn't be. And sometimes we will arrive at different judgments for good reason. I will always be accountable for and open to scrutiny on the judgments I make, but I will continue to take these judgments really carefully and with the best possible clinical advice. Even today, the changes we are announcing, although I think they are proportionate at this stage in the pandemic, because they balance the benefits of isolation with the disruption that isolation caused, they are not without risk. And that is why it's really important that we communicate them properly and that people understand not just what the easing of some of these rules are, but what we are asking people to do in place of these. And that applies to the changes on self-isolation, but it also applies to the changes around confirmatory PCR testing after an asymptomatic LFD positive result. Look, Douglas Ross and I have had exchanges in the past, and I say this non-pejoratively. This is the stuff of scrutiny and democracy. But at times in the past, if I had followed Douglas Ross, we would have removed the requirement for face coverings, I think, prematurely. We would not have some of the mitigations that we now have in schools that I think are seen to be really important. There have been differences, there will no doubt always be differences, but the trust placed in me, the responsibility placed in me by the Scottish people means that I have, with my ministers, the duty to weigh these things up carefully and, of course, be accountable for the judgments we arrive at.
Douglas Ross.
The First Minister mentioned there that the reason that Scotland remained an outlier was because of the clinical advice she received. So will she publish the clinical advice from last week, which meant this crucial change wasn't made, the clinical advice she has received this week, now the change has come into force? And she also mentioned about communicating properly. Yesterday, the Deputy First Minister, the man who sits in her cabinet in charge of COVID recovery, claimed that virus rates were lower in Scotland compared to England because of the actions taken by the SNP. But John Swinney was using data from before the SNP's restrictions were introduced. And the most recent data shows, in fact, the opposite of what he claimed. Tackling this virus is not a competition, but John Swinney tried to make it one. So why is the Minister for COVID Recovery using misleading data to make petty political points instead of giving people the accurate information they need?
First Minister.
I don't think that's the case at all, and I'll come on to most recent data in a second. Firstly, though, let me deal with this issue of outlier. When the changes to self-isolation for index cases was first announced, it was only England that it applied to. So for a period, England was an outlier. Last week, I think, Wales and Northern Ireland decided to introduce similar changes, and today we are doing likewise. At different times in this pandemic, we've come to different views substantively. Sometimes we've come to different views, or the same views, on different timescales. Right now, on protections, for example, Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland are in very, very similar positions in terms of restrictions on gatherings and some restrictions and protective measures in hospitality. England is an outlier on that, not just an outlier in a UK sense, but arguably an outlier in a European and more broadly a global sense. We all have a responsibility to reach judgments based on our clinical advice and the responsibility we have to keep the public in this most challenging of situations as safe as possible, and that's what I will always do to the best of my ability. In terms of the impact of the protective measures we have in place, it always has been and always will be very, very difficult, sometimes impossible, to prove causation between one measure and the outcomes in terms of virus rates. But I think common sense tells you that if we didn't have some restriction on large, potentially super spreader events right now, if we didn't have measures in place to try to stem, at least to some extent, the transmission in higher risk settings like hospitality, and if we weren't advising the public and the public weren't responding so magnificently well to advice to cut contacts, then high rates that we're seeing right now are likely to be even higher and the pressure on the NHS significant. So I think, are right to be trying to apply some break, notwithstanding the high levels of infection we face. I agree these things are not a competition. At times, Scotland's had lower levels of infection. At other times, we've had higher levels of infection. Right now, I think the levels of infection are lower, whether they will remain. That's certainly than England, perhaps slightly than Wales, not so much Northern Ireland. But that is likely to change. My final point would be, in relation to Deputy First Minister's use of the ONS data yesterday, he used the most up-to-date ONS data yesterday. I've cited in my statement today data that, as I understand it, has been published while I've been speaking, that is a week more up-to-date. There'll always be a lag in it, that I think will still show that our 1 in 20, very, very high, is still lower, certainly, than England. But these things are not a competition. We just all have to take the decisions and make the judgments that we think are best to try to navigate the safest possible course through that. And I will always seek to do that. I'll be held accountable and subject to scrutiny, and that's the nature of the job that I'm privileged to do.
Douglas Ross.
Well, I'm glad that's the nature of the job the First Minister is privileged to do, and therefore, hopefully, on this occasion, she will answer my question on clinical advice. It has obviously changed, according to her answer, from last week, when self-isolation rules remain the same, this week when they've changed. So will she agree to publish that? Because data is crucially important. John Swinney said that data from Public Health Scotland would be published today, but the First Minister in her statement has now said that will be Friday. This is vital information on hospitalisations because of COVID and hospitalisations because people are unvaccinated. It's information that's essential for the public to know why they're being asked to put up with restrictions on their lives. It makes it difficult for anyone to judge the COVID situation properly when the First Minister has information, but the public does not. So can she confirm that Friday's update with this information will include all the facts and figures that we've been calling for and that the public need?
First Minister.
I'm not sure it will contain everything the Scottish Conservatives have been calling for, because I think if we'd done everything the Scottish Conservatives have been calling for over the past few months, we would be in probably more of a difficult position than we are now. I've referenced some of the policy issues. We'll continue to take the best judgments we can, and we will continue to publish as much data and evidence as possible on the proviso that there is a confidence in the robustness of that data. We do publish evidence papers. We will continue to publish as far as reasonable and appropriate the evidence and the advice underpinning the decisions we take. Ultimately, though, these decisions do involve the application of judgment. That's what people elect me and my government to do, to take the responsibility to weigh up all of the factors and take the judgments and be held accountable for them. So last week, I did not think it was the case that the benefits of changing self-isolation would outweigh the risks. The higher transmission now, the bigger the burden of self-isolation on the economy has changed that judgment. And these are judgments that we will continue to have to make on a whole range of issues in the weeks to come. On the issue about the data that will be published on Friday, Public Health Scotland has been doing that work. It's important that that data is robust. So that data, and that will be the first results of the analysis, that will show the differentiation between those who are in hospital because of COVID, in other words, it's the reason for their admission, and those who are in hospital for another reason, but who have COVID, either they came in with it or perhaps contract it in hospital. That's important information to know. That's why we're doing that work carefully. But it's also important not to put too much store on that. And again, I refer to this in my statement. Just because somebody with COVID is in hospital for another reason doesn't take away the impact of COVID, because the fact they have COVID means that there has to be special infection control measures around that patient in terms of distancing and other things that apply. So that reduces further the capacity of the health service and increases the pressure. So it's important that we understand all these things as our knowledge about Omicron develops, but we shouldn't kid ourselves on that because somebody with COVID is in hospital for another reason, that somehow takes away all of the difficult impact of them having COVID has. So we'll continue to publish evidence, we'll continue to publish data, but I will also continue to do the job I'm elected to do, which is apply the judgment to all of that and reach decisions motivated by my desire, my responsibility to navigate the safest possible path through this pandemic.
Call Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by passing my condolences to all those that have lost a loved one? And I would like to also put on record my gratitude to our vaccinators, NHS and social care staff, and all frontline workers who have continued to work and keep us safe over the Christmas and New Year period. I welcome the changes being made to the self-isolation period. There will be a relief to public services and businesses who are feeling the impact. I also welcome the broadening of financial support to businesses associated with hospitality, in particular the events, taxi and beauty industry. Issues have been raised about the speed of distribution and the impact that has on risking businesses going bust and people losing jobs. So can the First Minister commit to speedier distribution of these funds? We all agree that we must confront and challenge disinformation online. It undermines public health. But that isn't helped by the government providing unclear or partial information. There is clearly a difference between being in hospital or intensive care with COVID and being in hospital or intensive care because of COVID, especially if there is an outbreak in a hospital. So surely the First Minister is basing her decisions partly on this information. If she isn't, then why not? And if she is, then she must have seen that data and she should share it now. So can the First Minister commit to this data being made available as a matter of urgency so we can maintain public confidence in the decisions being taken and why?
First Minister.
On the first point, councils are responsible for distributing the money we've made available. I know how hard they are working to get that out the door and into the bank accounts of businesses as quickly as possible. And businesses, particularly in the hospitality trade, will be being contacted over the course of this week. So I know councils are doing that at speed and that process will continue. In relation to the second part of Anna Sarwa's question there, I haven't seen the data around Omicron. Previously, data on this question was published by Public Health Scotland in relation to previous variants. I've not seen that data yet on Omicron. I've said in my initial statement, the first results of that analysis will be published on Friday, which is as soon as Public Health Scotland consider it will be in a robust state to publish. But lastly, this point, which I covered in my answer, well, in my statement and also in my answer to Douglas Ross, yes, there is a difference between somebody being in hospital because of COVID and in hospital for another reason but having COVID. But we shouldn't overstate that difference, because if they are in hospital with COVID, even if the reason for their admission is something other than COVID, the fact they have COVID means that they have to have the same protective infection control measures applied as somebody in hospital for COVID. So the impact on the individual may or may not be different. If you have another condition, having COVID potentially will exacerbate and complicate that other condition. But the impact on the hospital, on the National Health Service, is not as different as people try to suggest. The bed that is occupied by somebody with COVID is occupied with infection control measures around it, whether they're in because of COVID or in with COVID. So yes, let's understand this, but for goodness sake, let's not overstate the importance of that differentiation in terms of the impact of these admissions on the National Health Service.
Anna Sarwar.
I'm not sure the First Minister deliberately confuses the issue. No one is questioning whether having a patient with COVID impacts on hospital capacity, but what it does impact is on people thinking about how dangerous this variant is to them, their life and to their loved ones. So level of hospitalisations and levels of infection of those in intensive care due to the COVID outbreak is really, really significant and really important, and why people are measuring how they need to restrict their lives and how they live it and the impact it then has on businesses. But that data is really, really important, and people have been asking for it for weeks since Omicron broke out. So I think the urgency of it is really important so we can maintain public confidence in the restrictions being taken. So I would repeat the public health advice. The vaccine works. Please do go and get your vaccination. If you haven't had your first, second or booster dose, if it isn't too late, there isn't any embarrassment, please book an appointment and visit a drop-in clinic. Please also follow the restrictions. Please do take lateral flow tests. Please do go for PCR tests if you are eligible for doing so. Another issue I raised last week was testing capacity, and I note the new arrangements on testing. But issues still remain for the wider population and key workers, issues around PCR capacity, but also supply of LFD tests. And across Scotland, key workers in NHS and beyond are reporting waiting days for PCR test results, despite promises of a fast-track service for frontline workers. A number of staff are having been in touch, saying they're delayed from going back to work for days as a result of that capacity. So given the new protocols on testing, can the First Minister confirm that LFD supply and distribution issues have been resolved? And can she clarify who is now eligible for a PCR test? If you are symptomatic after an LFT, for example, should you go for a PCR test? Will there be new guidance published around PCR test eligibility? And will the new freed up capacity be prioritised for frontline NHS and social care workers?
First Minister.
Let me take these issues in turn, and they're all important issues, so forgive me, Presiding Officer, I'll try to do it as briefly as possible. I want to give substantive answers. Firstly, to return to this issue of the distinction between people in hospital with COVID and in hospital because of COVID. Anna Sarwar's points are not unimportant, and I'm not suggesting they are, but I would also ask him on the point he's making about severity, equally not to oversimplify things. As I said in my statement, all of the evidence we have so far, including the evidence from admissions to ICU in Scotland, which are not rising at the rate that hospital admissions are rising, suggests that the impact on individuals of Omicron is less severe than previous variants. Now, whether that's an inherent milder version of the virus or whether it's the effects of vaccination, we don't know for sure, but all of the evidence points to that. But there's two caveats we need to make there. One is, that is evidence that is based so far on the circulation of Omicron largely within younger populations, which throughout this pandemic have been less likely, not completely unlikely, but less likely to fall seriously ill. We need to continue to monitor that. If the spread, as is happening now, moves from younger populations into older age groups. That's the first caveat. The second caveat is about volume, that even if the rate of hospitalisation, therefore the severity, is much less, the sheer volume of cases will add up to significant pressure, is already adding up to significant pressure on the National Health Service. And that is not abstract or academic for people's health, because if the hospitals are so full of COVID cases that they can't treat in the way they want to other conditions, heart disease or whatever other conditions, that has an impact on people's health. So even if not all of the people in hospital are in because of COVID, that does not mean that we should be complacent in any way for any reason about the mounting pressure on our hospitals. And I hope that is clear. I recognise the points that have been made, but I appeal to opposition leaders not to oversimplify these issues, because I don't think that helps anyone. On the issue of testing, we will, with community transmission as high as it is just now, we will periodically have pressure on the testing system, and we are working on a Four Nations basis because most of our testing capacity is through the Four Nations system, although we also have quite considerable NHS Scotland testing capacity. We work on a daily basis to resolve and to flex the capacity as far as possible. Right now, there's no shortage in Scotland of LFD tests. We monitor the supply of those very carefully. And issues that we were seeing with turnaround times have improved again, and turnaround times have become much shorter again. The essential workers route to prioritise PCR testing is there. There's also the sectoral exemption process that is available to NHS workers and key workers in other sectors. And lastly, we will ensure that there is guidance on the latest testing advice. But let me, I think I did make this point clear in my statement, but if I didn't, let me repeat it. If you have symptoms of COVID, then even if you've taken an LFD test that is positive, the advice is to still book a PCR test. It is only if you have no symptoms and your LFD test is positive that we're then saying there's no need to take a PCR test, not just because we're trying to maximise testing capacity, but because it is a pretty safe assumption, given levels of transmission right now, that you are positive, because the false positive rate is so low. And working on the basis of that positive LFD test allows the contact tracing process to kick in as quickly as possible. Obviously, if you have symptoms, there's a variety of reasons that we would still want PCR testing to happen, not least as we get more antiviral treatment to allow us to assess patients who are most likely to benefit from that.
I call Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. At the start of this pandemic, the government carried opposition party support for public health measures by providing us with almost real-time information about the advance of the virus. It meant that we were all signed up to the precautionary principle of hinging decisions around data rather than dates. But that transparency has ebbed away. 6 weeks of Omicron in Scotland, and we will only learn on Friday who is in hospital specifically because of Omicron severity, despite some of those details already making their way into the national press. If the First Minister is still leading the public health response to COVID on the basis of data and not dates, does she recognise the importance of being more transparent with the information she has if she's to bring us with her? And secondly, can I ask specifically about PCR testing? Price information published by the government at lunchtime, in answer to my request last week, has revealed that PCR testing capacity is actually quite significantly down on what it was last year, to a little over 50,000 tests a day. Does she recognise that this will have resulted in health workers waiting, in some cases, days for a negative result?
First Minister.
Let me take both of those questions. Firstly, the reason that I'm not sharing the data on people in hospital because of COVID versus people in hospital with COVID is not because I'm not being transparent, because I don't have that data yet, because Public Health Scotland are doing careful work to make sure that that data, when it is published, is robust and reliable. They published data on that question previously with the past variants of the virus, and they're doing that work again. So it's not trying to hide that data. We want to make sure it is reliable and that what is published is data that people can have confidence in, and it will be published on Friday because that's when Public Health Scotland consider they will reach that state. There's no point in publishing data that is not reliable because it doesn't help anybody. Beyond that, I'll continue to be as open and transparent as possible about data, about evidence. But ultimately, as I've said before, the data and the evidence doesn't make the decisions, it informs the decisions. The decisions have to be taken by those of us who are elected to carry that responsibility. And that does involve the application of judgment. And that is what I'm elected to do, and it's what I am held accountable for. But we'll be as open and transparent as we have been all along about the data and the evidence underpinning that. But I make no apology for wanting that data to be as robust as it can possibly be. On the issue of testing capacity, I don't accept that characterisation. As of today, in terms of the UK testing network, Scotland's allocation share of that is about 50,000 a day. Over and above that, we have NHS Scotland capacity of around 32,000 per day. That testing is fluctuating at the moment. It always fluctuates for a variety of reasons. If there's, you know, equipment failure in one of the labs, for example, then it will be down a bit while that is repaired. But right now, as with so many other parts of society, one of the reasons for fluctuation is staff absences because of COVID and self-isolation in our laboratory network, which is another reason the changes announcing today are at the moment, I think, appropriate. But we continue to work with UK government colleagues to maximise testing capacity on a daily basis. But we need to see testing capacity, not just as PCR, important though that is, but to utilise fully the LFD capacity as well, which is what lies behind the testing change that I've announced today.
Thank you. Understandably, there's a great deal of interest from members to put questions to the First Minister, and I would be grateful for more succinct questions and responses. And it is my intention to allow this session to continue beyond the scheduled time in order to take as many questions as possible. I call Gillian Martin to be followed by Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I note in the First Minister's statement that adjustments to the isolation advice have been made. And I'm certain that people are respectful of advice given based on the science, and I trust that it's the science behind the government's decision. So I won't ask the First Minister to go over again the clinical basis that there is for these adjustments, because she's been more than comprehensive today. But the First Minister has said that fully vaccinated close contacts of those who have tested positive but who themselves have a full week's worth of negative lateral flow results will not have to isolate beyond 7 days. Now, in my area, people have told me that they are sometimes finding it challenging to get hold of enough lateral flow tests, particularly when they've got large families. Can the First Minister say what's been done to ensure that a supply in every area is available to make sure everyone can play their part in protecting others and to test at home?
First Minister.
Thank you. Can I just be clear that the change for fully vaccinated close contacts, including household contacts, is that the requirement to self-isolate at all will be replaced by daily lateral flow tests for 7 days. So as long as on each day your lateral flow is negative, you don't have to isolate. But on any day, of course, that your lateral flow test is positive, you do then have to start isolation. Again, that's something we've considered carefully. We think the benefits outweigh the risks, but none of this, of course, is risk-free. But we think this is a proportionate change overall at this stage. It does mean, of course, that the supply of lateral flow devices always important is even more important. So through all of the various routes, we're working with UK colleagues, with colleagues in the community pharmacy network, in the local testing centres, to make sure that there is a good supply of LFDs. There's no shortage at the moment. Procurement is ongoing to make sure supplies continue to be topped up. So right now you can mail order LFDs, you can get them from local pharmacy places or local testing centres, and a number of councils are making lateral flow devices available in other places as well. There's also the key worker workplace testing, which businesses that are part of that know how to access.
Sandesh Gulhani to be followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you. First Minister, the Scottish people are struggling under the restrictions that are in place, some of which have been in place for a long time. Look, we all appreciate that COVID necessitates some restrictions, but what information does the Scottish Government base its decisions upon? We simply don't know. And so to help the people better understand, and in terms of transparency, will you commit to publish weekly, ahead of the announcement, all the data the Cabinet bases its decisions upon?
First Minister.
We've published acres of data and evidence. We will continue to do that. But I come back to the point, the data and the evidence doesn't make the decisions, they inform the decisions. Look, I would hazard a guess that the member, who I know is a clinician himself, is in a minority of clinicians right now who don't think, or who think that no protective measures are required. Indeed, Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland, many countries across Europe and the world are all in a similar place in some proportionate but necessary protections to try to stem, even to some extent, the rise in cases. And what is the rationale behind that? We know, particularly with Omicron, given its greater transmissibility and infectiousness, that large-scale events have the potential to quickly become super-spreading events, which is why we have, regrettably, put a temporary restriction on large events. We know that the kind of environments in hospitality where people come together, often poorly ventilated, with alcohol, roaring inhibitions, also raises risk of transmission, particularly with a greater transmissible variant. So that's the rationale for the particular targeted measures we have in place. We know from evidence that face coverings help, perhaps more than many other measures, reduce transmission. So actually, and I would expect somebody clinically qualified probably to understand this better than most, that all of these targeted measures that are in place right now are in place in many, many other countries, and all of them flow from our understanding of how a virus spreads, and in particular, given its greater transmissibility, the risks that the spread of Omicron presents.
Jackie Bailey, to be followed by Jim Fairley.
Contrary to what the First Minister said earlier, the Deputy First Minister did cite ONS data to justify his argument about how much better we're doing in Scotland because of restrictions here. The data he used covered the period up to the 23rd of December. That, of course, was before restrictions were introduced, when the rules were largely the same in Scotland and in England. Analysis by the Financial Times showed that the 7-day rolling average of cases up to the 3rd of January has Scotland with a higher percentage case numbers than England. ONS figures published today show largely the same level of infections in Scotland and England, other than in London. So I absolutely agree with the First Minister that this is not a competition, but would she agree with me that it is essential that ministers do not spin statistics and create misinformation, which would weaken public confidence?
First Minister.
I don't think anybody's seeking to do that. It's not a competition, but since I've been asked these things, you know, let me lay it again. The Deputy First Minister cited ONS statistics yesterday. I didn't say he didn't. What I said was that he cited the most up-to-date ONS statistics, which until 2 o'clock today were the ones he cited yesterday. We have further data today that I've already cited, so I won't go into detail again. I would urge significant caution about the rolling average, 7-day rolling average of cases up to the 3rd of January in any part of the UK because of the disruption to reporting over the Christmas and then the New Year holiday period, and the different pattern of testing we know is there when there is a holiday period. So I think I would treat those figures with significant caution. And also, as I've said, we know that the daily reported cases are a significant underestimate in all countries of the true prevalence of the virus. But you know, if Jackie really wants to make this point and, you know, get an assessment of the overall performance of Scotland to date, because it may change next week or next month, then overall, in terms of the pandemic to date, levels of infection in Scotland, and you can go into the UK government COVID dashboards and see this for yourself, overall levels of infection in Scotland are lower than I think in all other parts of the UK, certainly England and Wales. I can't recall exactly if that's the case for Northern Ireland. So does that say we've managed our way through this pandemic perfectly? Absolutely not. But it does suggest that the balance of judgments that we're taking, sometimes we'll get them more right than on other occasions, the balance of judgment have led us to that position. But I'm not complacent about this. We face ahead of us a really difficult period. And that's why my responsibility is just to take the decisions based on data and evidence, but applying my judgment, which is my job, the decisions that I think are likely to get us through this as safely as possible. And if they accord with decisions elsewhere in the UK, all good and well. But if they don't, then that will be for good reason, that it is then my responsibility to set out for people and to allow people to decide.
Before I move on to take Jim Fairley, I have a point of order from Sandesh Gulhani. Mr. Gulhani.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I seek your clarification as to the fact that the First Minister completely misrepresented my position. At no point have I ever been against all restrictions. At no point have I ever been doing the things that I have been accused of, and that was absolutely not my question.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Gulhani. That is not a point of order, but your comment has obviously been recorded. I now move on to take Jim Fairley, who will be followed by Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, President Officer, and a very happy new year to yourself. And while the support for the hospitality sector is very welcome, can the First Minister outline how it will be targeted, and will there be a particular attention paid to locally owned and family-run businesses as opposed to multinational chains?
First Minister.
It's important that the support is targeted. I covered some of this last week, that there is a generic element to our hospitality support, but we're also looking at how we target other sectors in a more tailored way. Overall, we're providing, I think, £113 million to support hospitality and leisure sectors impacted by the latest public health measures. Local and family-owned businesses absolutely must receive that support. All eligible hospitality businesses who previously got support through the Strategic Framework Business Fund will receive a top-up payment, and they will be contacted directly by the local authority. That's the work that is already underway. They don't have to make a new application. So hospitality premises with a rateable value of up to and including £51,000 will receive a grant of £4,500, and those with a rateable value of £51,001 or above will receive a grant of £6,800.
Call Oliver Mundell to be followed by Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Last year saw education attainment figures, which even in the context of the pandemic, make a mockery of Nicola Sturgeon's promise that education would be her top priority. We simply cannot afford any more unavoidable disruption to learning. But can the First Minister tell us how many additional non-classroom committed teachers can be called upon to cover lessons? What other additional resources are being made available to keep our schools open? And finally, can she confirm that every pupil in Scotland now has access to an electronic device to support remote learning in the event that they're required to self-isolate?
First Minister.
I think possibly Oliver Mundell meant to ask me that we would ensure no disruption due to avoidable reasons, not unavoidable reasons. I don't want to see any further disruption to children's education because of the impact on attainment, not just in Scotland, but as any reasonable person knows, in all parts of the UK and indeed in countries across the world. That's why we are determined to keep schools open. We have already provided additional resources, so there are additional teachers already in our schools with plans to recruit more teachers. As a result of that resource, we have said what we have done, what we have said we would do in terms of electronic devices to pupils, starting of course with those in the most deprived circumstances. In terms of the situation more widely, as I'm sure Oliver Mundell is aware, guidance was issued before Christmas to schools, basically looking at some of the things schools could do to make the environments as safe as possible. For example, how to minimise contacts through groupings where practicable indoors, tightening restrictions on school visitors, updated advice on ventilation and CO2 monitoring, updated advice on asymptomatic testing. But in relation to staffing, and I'm sure Oliver Mundell is aware of this, the Scottish Negotiating Committee for Teachers has previously agreed a number of contingencies for flexible staff resourcing to maintain continuity in education. So, for example, the ability, if necessary, to combine classes and stages, increase class contact time, or relocate staff temporarily. So those arrangements are already in place. And of course, our funding for additional teachers is already resulting in more than 2,000 more teachers in our schools than was the case before the start of the pandemic. And of course, right now, the ratio of pupil to teachers is at its lowest level, partly because of that additional recruitment since 2009.
Claire Adamson, to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, you've already alluded to the huge challenges faced by countries across the globe from Omicron. In December, John Cummings described Omicron as spreading at lightning speed as he introduced restrictions on citizens out with the EU from travelling to or through France. Post-Brexit, of course, the UK is a third country in EU terms. What are the implications of this for Scotland, particularly for our exporters?
First Minister.
Well, I mean, it's an important issue to raise. It is, of course, for individual countries to determine what requirements travellers need to meet for entry into their territory. So it's for the French authorities to decide whether or not to and when to follow the example of, for example, Germany and reopen access to UK nationals. But there's no doubt that post-Brexit arrangements have been a factor in the temporary French decision to prevent UK nationals transiting France to homes or destinations elsewhere in the EU. That is one of the many, many damaging consequences of no longer being a member of the EU, and is one of a long, long list of reasons why I regret that decision, and I think many people across Scotland regret it too.
Gillian Mackay, to be followed by Willie Coffey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. 11 local authorities returned to school today, and school staff, pupils and parents are understandably anxious about what effect the Omicron surge will have. Many teachers will be opening windows to ensure adequate ventilation, but with temperatures close to freezing, this creates other problems. Will the First Minister consider deploying some of the money currently allocated to economic support to instead assist local councils to purchase air filtration units for classrooms which require them?
First Minister.
Of course, we'll continue to consider all suggestions like that. We have a separate fund available to help businesses with ventilation, so we will certainly look at the scope and the eligibility for that. We have already, as Gillian Mackay knows, provided councils with additional funding to do CO2 monitoring. Councils should already be acting on the outcomes of that to make improvements to ventilation, including air filtration systems where that is necessary. But we understand the impact on councils, and therefore we'll continue to talk to them about what further support we can provide. I think the other thing I would want to acknowledge is how anxious a time this is for young people going back to school, but also teachers and other staff in schools, and for parents. This is not the position any of us wanted to be in. I think for reasons we all understand, keeping young people in school with as normal a school experience as possible is really, really important. But that requires steps and mitigations to be taken to keep schools safe, or as safe as possible in the situation that we face right now. It also makes it important that those in the 12 to 15 age groups eligible for second dose of vaccination come forward to take that up. And of course, we'll continue to pay close attention to future advice from the JCVI on extending vaccination to other groups of young people.
Willie Coffey, to be followed by Donald Cameron.
Thank you. The First Minister will be aware that in every constituency there are a high number of businesses like the salons and barber shops and so on who are experiencing a lack of footfall due to the necessary precautions, and many have significant staff absences too. Given that the Barnett formula means that Scotland only gains access to its own financial resources if the UK government decides that England needs financial help, what indication has the Scottish Government had from the UK Government that it will extend support to those businesses who can remain open but whose trade has been drastically affected? Or will we continue to have to support those sectors from our own resources, as just announced by the First Minister?
First Minister.
We've no further indication further to what was announced by the Chancellor before Christmas of any additional support being in the pipeline from the UK Government to businesses either in England or that would then flow to businesses elsewhere in the UK. And my views on the constraints of the funding arrangements generally, but in particular in the situation we face right now, are well known, and Willie Coffey has articulated them again. So we are providing as much support as we can from within our own resources. I think it is right that we do that, but there are limitations to that. But some of the businesses that Willie Coffey has referred to today, salons, hairdressing, barber salons, for example, will benefit from the allocation that I've spoken about earlier on, and hopefully, while it won't fully compensate, these businesses will go some way to easing the pressure they're dealing with.
Donald Cameron, to be followed by Martin Whitfield.
Thank you. Of the 1,223 people in Scotland in hospital with COVID today, approximately how many have not been vaccinated?
First Minister.
I don't have that information to hand. I will check with Public Health Scotland to see whether we can get that information, and if so, I'll make sure that is published. What we do know beyond any doubt is that being vaccinated, fully vaccinated with a booster or a third dose of the vaccine, significantly reduces the likelihood of becoming seriously ill and therefore being vaccinated. So we know that, and I will check what information and how up to date the information is in terms of the vaccination status of those who are currently in hospital.
Martin Whitfield, to be followed by Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you. The First Minister's call for increased testing in schools is the exact same approach that the government has said at each stage, yet the result has been a steady testing rate at schools of pupils of below 5%. Labour's written to the government with a raft of suggestions, including mobile testing units in schools, and indeed the availability of mass testing at certain primary and secondary schools. So when will this government have created a culture of testing in our schools that is needed to understand the spread of the virus and also to help our schools stay open and safe?
First Minister.
There already is mass access to lateral flow testing for secondary school pupils and staff in education settings. This is about encouraging people to make use of that, and we've all got a part to play in that. We can't force people to use the testing, but we can strongly encourage it. We have seen across the population over the last few weeks, as we've been dealing with the Omicron surge, a significant increase in the uptake of lateral flow testing, and I certainly hope that will be reflected in the approach to school testing as the new term begins. So we will always continue to do everything we can to encourage people of the importance of testing and the benefits both to them and to the wider population of taking full advantage of it.
Eleanor Whittam, to be followed by Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Recognising the important role that our health and social care partnerships play in delivering critical and essential care package services and the pressures they are currently operating under with limited staffing and a build-up in demand, and noting that East Ayrshire, one of the exemplar partnerships in where I'm still a councillor, is struggling at this time and looking at a range of temporary alternatives whilst recruitment is ongoing to bring in additional staff to support the increase in demand, can I ask the First Minister what supports the Scottish Government can provide to assist health and social care partnerships at this critical time?
First Minister.
Well, I mean, firstly, Eleanor Whittam is right to cite East Ayrshire as an exemplar partnership. I think they do really good work, but like all partnerships at the moment, they are under significant and increasing pressure. That is likely to remain the case for this foreseeable future as we continue to navigate our way through the latest phase of the pandemic. We've already allocated significant funding to all health and social care partnerships to support them through winter. So that includes, for example, £40 million for interim care for people leaving hospital, £20 million to enhance multidisciplinary working, and a further £15 million to recruit additional health support workers. And that's on top of I think over £60 million to enhance care at home capacity and funding to increase the hourly rate of pay to make these jobs more attractive. So we continue to work really closely with councils and with health and care partnerships to try to navigate our way collectively through this. But this is not easy and is not going to be easy in the weeks to come for the NHS or for social care, which brings me back to my central point. Difficult though it is, if we can all follow the guidance and follow and abide by the protections in place right now, we will help to some extent to stem transmission and to ease that pressure, even if just a bit.
Sue Webber to be followed by Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Will the First Minister apologise to my colleague, Dr. Sandesh Gulhani, for the blatant misrepresentation of his position?
First Minister.
I don't think I've got any need to do that. I didn't intend to misrepresent anybody. I don't intend to misrepresent anybody. But Dr. Sandesh was, as I heard it, suggesting that the restrictions and protective measures were in place, as he put it, for some time, lacked evidence. And I was saying, and I said, and I will say again, I thought particularly for somebody who's clinically qualified, the reasons for these targeted interventions was obvious, and so obvious that many other countries, all other countries apart from England and the UK and many other countries across the world, were implementing very similar measures. I heard what he said to me as indicative of him not agreeing with these protective measures. If that's not what he intended to say, then I accept that, and you know, his position is as he's put on the record. But I do repeat that he, of all people, presumably understands the rationale and the evidence base for the targeted measures that are in place in Scotland.
I call Neil Gray to be followed by Pam Duncan Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and Happy New Year. As children return to nursery and other childcare settings this week, including my two-year-old daughters, can the First Minister advise what support is currently being made available to private nurseries, which, like other sectors, are struggling with staffing related to COVID? And can she also advise what the current guidance is for testing under fives, as some childcare settings appear to be requesting proof of negative PCR tests for attendance?
First Minister.
Well, we continue to do all we can to support education settings, including early years settings that are experiencing reduced staffing levels right now, because we know this is a really difficult and stressful time. The changes to self-isolation that I've announced today will help with that and will help the early years and childcare sector, as well as other sectors. It will mean that the sectoral exemption process that came into effect before Christmas is no longer required. In relation to the second part of the question, children, just to be clear about this, children under 5 years old are required to get a test where they have COVID symptoms. Children under 5 years who are identified as close contacts, though, are encouraged but not required to be tested. So I hope that distinction is clear.
Pam Duncan Glancy to be followed by Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and a Happy New Year. Unpaid carers are absolutely broken. Many haven't had a break for nearly 2 years, and now health boards are asking them to step in even more to help with delayed discharge. What new action will the government take to support unpaid carers? And considering they still have a key role in the response, will the government guarantee that the carers allowance supplement will be doubled again this year?
First Minister.
Look, we'll continue to do everything we can to support unpaid carers through the carers allowance supplement. Scotland's the only part of the UK that has a carers allowance supplement, and I am personally very committed to maximising that. We have doubled it over the course of the pandemic, and we'll continue to maximise the support through that. Unpaid carers, everybody is struggling with the impact of this pandemic, but there is no doubt that some of the most difficult toll is being felt by unpaid carers who already have a really difficult set of challenges to deal with on a daily basis, as well as the additional financial support. Some of the changes I've announced today, reducing the pressure on the formal social care service, I hope will help with that, and reducing the pressure overall on the NHS will help avoid, I hope, some of the additional pressure that otherwise will be put on unpaid carers. This is one of the most, in a whole series of difficult and concerning aspects of what we're dealing with right now, this is one of the most difficult and concerning. I can't magic away the impact of this virus, but all that we are doing is about trying to reduce these burdens as much as possible, and we'll continue to make sure that unpaid carers don't get ignored, absolutely don't get ignored in that wider consideration.
Siobhan Brown to be followed by Jamie Halcrow-Johnston.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've recently been contacted by a constituent who is concerned about the social care that his mother receives due to COVID and all the staff absences, services have been cut, so time slots for care can no longer be given. With the new Omicron variant and the increased staff absences crippling many sectors, including the NHS, rail, bus and ferry services, can I ask what engagement the Scottish Government has had with local authorities to combat absences across the care sector due to COVID?
First Minister.
Well, I mean, just following on my answer to Pam Duncan-Glancy, where I talked about how worrying the additional pressure on unpaid carers is, it is also a cause of real concern to me and to the government at the impact that COVID and staff absences because of COVID is having on social care packages, the reduction of support that is available, time slots not being available of the many things that concern me about the current situation. These aspects are right up there at the top of the list. I think what we've announced today in terms of self-isolation will help with that, but we need to get COVID rates down to reduce that pressure overall and allow services to return more to normal and to do that as quickly as possible. In terms of engagement with local councils, we engage on an ongoing basis with local councils individually and collectively, of course, through COSLA. But the Deputy First Minister, along with the Cabinet Secretaries for Local Government and Health, is meeting COSLA this afternoon to discuss collectively what more we can do to try to address these particular challenges around unpaid care and social care more generally.
Jamie Halper-Johnson, to be followed by Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There's still over £100 million of the business support previously announced by the Scottish Government still to be allocated. That money is clearly not supporting Scottish Government's bank accounts in Edinburgh. So can the First Minister tell us when it will be allocated by her government and when it will start hitting the bank accounts of those businesses across Scotland that need it so much?
First Minister.
Well, the majority of it is allocated and therefore work is underway to get it into bank accounts as soon as possible. I've covered all that today, but we are continuing to consult with other sectors that perhaps haven't had support before or need more targeted support about how we can best use the remainder of that, and we will do that as quickly as possible. It's worth saying, just for the record, that of course in the part of the UK where the Member's Party is in charge, this is funding that isn't even available in to the extent that it's available in Scotland. So yes, we want to consult properly to get this money as targeted as we can to those who need it most and to get it into bank accounts as quickly as possible. But it is money that, but for the actions of the Scottish Government, it wouldn't be there at all.
Paul O'Kane, to be followed by Joe Fitzpatrick.
Constituents in Inverclyde with family living in care homes have contacted me deeply concerned by a return to a strict no visitor policy, as I understand on the basis of advice from local public health teams due to some staff awaiting PCR results. This is contrary to the current guidance that one visitor should be allowed during a controlled outbreak. Indeed, Donald McCaskill, Chief Executive of Scottish Care, has expressed concern that there is inconsistency on visiting rules due to public health teams or incident management teams' interpretation of what is a managed or controlled outbreak. So will the First Minister clarify the guidance on care home visiting and ask Public Health Scotland to communicate that clearly to local teams to ensure that people living in care homes can have regular visitors, as is their right?
First Minister.
Firstly, I inadvertently misquoted Donald McCaskill last week when the line, I think, between Willie Rennie and I had broken up a bit. So I've apologised to him privately for that. Let me take the opportunity to do it publicly today as well. So I'll take care not to inadvertently do that again today. He is raising, I think, very legitimate concerns about, firstly, the need for the mental health and wellbeing of care home residents and their families to continue with safe visiting, but also to make sure that visiting is safe and that we're taking all necessary precautions. Some of what I've announced today, of course, will have an impact on the self-isolation rules and testing as affects care homes. So therefore, I will ask Public Health Scotland or through the Scottish Government for updated guidance to be published so that there is clarity about the rules and any changes as a result of what we've announced today. Final point I would make is that, though, is this: we're determined to keep visiting possible and happening in care homes for the reasons everybody understands. But we must make sure that we are taking appropriate precautions in care homes. We are seeing an increasing number of outbreaks in care homes at the moment, reflective, of course, of the increased community transmission, so therefore appropriate precautions are necessary to make sure we're keeping people in care homes as safe as possible.
Joe Fitzpatrick to be followed by Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The requirement to limit attendance at indoor spectator sports to 200 is significantly impacting revenue from ticket sales for sports such as ice hockey, netball and basketball, including the Dundee Stars, a professional ice hockey club in my constituency. Can the First Minister provide any further details, particularly in relation to timescales, on how the £5 million she announced today will support such professional sports clubs?
First Minister.
Well, the fact that we've allocated the £5 million today, I think, is an indication that we know the impact that the restrictions on large gatherings and spectator sports is having on the profitability and, at some points, no doubt, the viability of sports and sports clubs. We are working with Sports Scotland and as quickly as possible with, for example, ice hockey and basketball clubs, as well as football, rugby and horse racing, to determine fully the financial impact that the current measures are having. And we then, following that, will get the money to clubs as quickly as possible. As I said, I think I said last week, for some sports, there will be the ability to recoup these losses as events start to be rescheduled, hopefully in the not too distant future. For others, that will be more difficult. So we need to make sure we're getting the money where it is needed most. But that work has been taken forward.
I never paid him actually, but he came in.
Sorry, I think there's some interruption there, First Minister. Are we content to move on to the next question? I believe that we are, and I will call Tess White to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, three things you said earlier resonated: publishing evidence, application of judgment. So of the £168 million announced by the Scottish Government on the 29th of December in relation to business support, are you able to say, please, how much has been allocated to North East businesses and when will it actually get to those who really need it in order to survive? Thank you.
First Minister.
Well, as I've said, I think on several occasions now, local authorities are, as we speak, doing that work. So over the course of this week, I think, and I'll be corrected if I'm getting this figure wrong, but from memory, I think around 14,000 hospitality businesses will be contacted so that these grants can be paid without the need for further applications. In due course, of course, we'll be able to break down the allocation of this money by different area, and the answer to the question that has been asked there will be available. So this is happening really quickly. Councils are working really hard on this, and that is, I think, what everybody would expect. But I'll make the point I made a moment ago. It's really important we get this money out to businesses. But this is money that is not available elsewhere in the UK, because the Scottish Government, unlike the UK Government, has decided to dig into our own funding to make really difficult decisions to provide this support. And therefore, while yes, it takes time for the administrative processes to get this money into bank accounts, if you're a business in other parts of the UK, this is money that will never get to your bank accounts because it's money that is not available.
Call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Maurice Golden.
Thank you. Successive waves of COVID variants have presented different challenges, and we've covered many of them today. Further variants may well arise, and I note that the Scottish Government now plans to publish a strategic framework in the next few weeks. Can the First Minister give any further detail as to what may be contained in this framework and what research and preparations beyond the immediate priorities are being put in place now?
First Minister.
It's a good question. It's one of the most important issues we'll grapple with over the next few weeks. I mean, in light of what we've experienced so far with different variants, we've taken steps to better understand and detect these things earlier. So the investments we've made around wastewater sampling, for example, and genomic sequencing, these are really important resilience steps so that we are better equipped and prepared, hopefully, to pick up new variants more quickly and try to contain and suppress them. More generally than that, you were 2 years into a pandemic, partly because of the financial constraints devolved governments work within, but more generally because of the harm restrictions do we can't go on managing this virus only through restrictions. To be fair, we haven't been doing that for some time, but increasingly we need to find different ways of managing it. I'm not of the just let it rip kind of mentality, because I think we do need to try to control and manage it, but we need to find more proportionate and sustainable ways of doing that. That's not easy, but it is essential, and that's the work that we are continuing to do right now. It's also the case, certainly with Omicron, and we don't know if there will be future variants, whether this will be true too, that the kind of measures, that difficult though they were, that would have suppressed earlier variants, will not do that with Omicron to the same extent, because it is so much more transmissible. So the use of restrictions or protective measures is becoming less tolerable, it's becoming less affordable, it's doing more harm, but with Omicron, also perhaps less effective because of the greater transmissibility. So some of what we're doing, like the changes we've announced today, it's about different judgments of risk and benefit, and we need to do that across different areas of society. What I would say lastly is to business in particular, who understandably and often call on me and the government to just let us live with COVID, you will need to continue, as many of you have been, to put in place the adaptations that enable us to do that. So that's the kind of work we're doing just now, and we will put more detail on exactly what that means in practice as we get to the conclusion of the work that I spoke about earlier.
Maurice Golden, to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister suggested restrictions on large gatherings will remain until at least the 17th of January, perilously close to Scotland hosting the Six Nations Games in February. This could be a big boost to struggling hospitality, but they need clarity. Can fans go ahead and book tickets, and can venues order stock and plan shifts?
First Minister.
Look, the one thing there's many things I've really, really wished that I had over the course of this pandemic, and one of them is a crystal ball, to be able to see into the future with certainty. And I don't say that to be facetious in any way. It is really difficult, particularly at this stage of a phase of a wave of the virus, to be certain about the future. That's why we need to monitor things on a closer time basis, but we have right throughout had very good discussions with the SRU about matches at Murrayfield. They have been very, very constructive at working with us to enable games to go ahead. I know how important clarity is for those who cater for big sporting events and not least matches at Murrayfield. So that's very much in our mind as we take decisions. I hope very much we won't have to go beyond the 17th of January with these restrictions. All of us, you know, including myself, want to be able to cheer Scotland on at Murrayfield in the Six Nations. But I don't do anybody any good if I try to give certainty ahead of our ability to do that. But we will continue to use the data, use the evidence, reach the judgments that get that clarity and certainty as quickly as possible. And I certainly do very firmly hope that these matches will go ahead and will go ahead to crowds of supporters.
Stuart McMillan, to be followed by Craig Hoy.
Happy New Year, working in to link the fire alarms. Make, however, with the increased number of people having to self-isolate, what flexibility can the First Minister provide for those households where they've not been able to enter another home at this time?
Mr. McMillan, there may have been some interruption there to your broadcast. I just want to confirm that the First Minister has heard sufficient of your question. First Minister?
Unfortunately, I'm not sure I did, Presiding Officer. I'm not sure I heard sufficient of that to even make an educated guess about the question. So I don't know if it's possible to ask Stuart to repeat it.
Yeah, I'll go back to Mr. McMillan. Mr. McMillan, could you begin again,
no
please?
No problem at all. No problem at all. Thank you, Presiding Officer. The presence of working interlinked alarm that they make, however, with the increasing number of people having to self-isolate due to the highly transmissible Omicron variant, what flexibility can the First Minister provide to those households where installation of linked systems is delayed due to people not being able to enter another home at this time.
First Minister.
I think I heard that being about the installation of smoke and heat alarm systems. So if I'm wrong about that and I'm about to answer a question that was not asked, I apologise in advance. There is a requirement for homeowners to install these alarms by the 1st of February, but there's also flexibility for homeowners who are unable to do it by that date. Mains wired alarms can be fitted by an electrician, or longer life battery alarms can be fitted by residents themselves. But the important thing is nobody will be breaking the law or criminalised if they need more time. There's no penalties for non-compliance. So the issues around the impact of self-isolation, I think, are catered for in the broader arrangements that are in place. But again, Presiding Officer, if I have answered a different question to the one Stuart McMillan has asked me there, if he wants to perhaps send my office an email after this session, I'll be happy to provide an appropriate answer.
And Craig Hoy, to be followed by Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Dr. Gilhani called for the data that underpins the government's decisions, the very data that the First Minister says she doesn't have. Rather than falling back on the weasel words that she did with my colleague Sue Webber, will she agree to go back and look at the official report of what Dr. Gilhani said and then come back to apologise to Parliament next week?
Thank you, Mr. Hoy, and I will just take this opportunity to remind all members at all times to treat one another with courtesy and respect. And I call on the First Minister to respond to Mr. Hoy.
And I always seek to do so, Presiding Officer. Look, the data under what is the data? The data is published on a daily basis. We've seen over the past week an 87% increase in recorded cases of Omicron. We see today, published by the Office of National Statistics, the fact that 1 in 20 people across Scotland right now probably have COVID. It probably is a bit higher than that now because these statistics are from a few days ago. We're seeing a rising number of people in our hospitals because of or with COVID. And therefore, that's the data that informs the decisions. We also have developing data, which doesn't need the Scottish Government to publish it because it's published by people globally, about the increased transmissibility of Omicron. That data is there, and it's available to not just members of this Parliament, but to anybody across the country. And what we do is take that data and the evidence of the impact of Omicron, and we apply our judgment to what measures will help us stem transmission. And as I've said, the increased transmissibility means that that involves, regrettably, restricting large, potentially super spreader events and trying to contain transmission in settings that we know have a higher risk because of low ventilation or the kind of behaviours that happen in those settings. So I'm not sure what evidence and data of this is missing. We continue to publish evidence, and the fact that many other countries are doing similar or the same as us suggests that it's not just the Scottish Government that thinks this evidence justifies those actions. Now, lastly, because I do take this seriously, these are important issues. We agonise over these decisions. I spend most waking hours and thinking, as is my job, about the right balance of judgment to apply here. And you know, I don't try to misrepresent people, but I would also ask people to go back and listen to the member's question. And my impression from that question was that he was not in support of the measures that were in place. Now, that's legitimate, and I answered the question on that basis. If that was not the impression he was intending to give, then I accept that, and I hope he will accept in turn that I was not seeking to misrepresent him. I think we've all got more important things, frankly, to deal with right now because of the really significant challenge that the country is facing.
And Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Some people currently living with long COVID, and some with COVID caught nearly 2 years before widespread testing, have no proof of a past PCR test and consequently had difficulty accessing the treatment and support they need. Given the change announced today regarding no requirement for a PCR test where a lateral flow test is positive with no symptoms, can the First Minister provide assurance that those who may go on to develop long COVID in the future and have not had a PCR test to confirm will not have similar delayed treatment experiences like the first waivers?
First Minister.
Yes, I can give that assurance in summary terms. I'm happy to ask the Health Secretary to write to the member to set out that assurance in more detail. Of course, and this question also gives me the opportunity to reiterate an important point here. When you do an LFD, a lateral flow test, whether it's positive or negative, you should record that result through the website that allows that to happen. That's particularly important, obviously, if the test is positive, because not just will there then be that record of that, but it means that Test and Protect kicks in. This is something that we can do in Scotland. We can trigger the contact tracing on the strength of lateral flow test results and not just PCR tests. So these are important points, and I'll make sure that the Health Secretary sets out the detail of that in more depth. But this is about making sure we both use fully all of our testing capacity across the different modes of testing, but also make sure that when it is, you know, highly, highly likely that somebody has COVID, even if they don't have symptoms, the advice and contact tracing kicks in as quickly as possible.
That concludes the statement by Nicola Sturgeon, First Minister, on COVID-19 update. My apologies to those members who were unable to put a question, and I close this meeting.